Hi everyone, today we are going to discuss about dialyser reprocessing or reuse. Myself Dr Jigar Shrimali, I am consultant nephrologist and transplant physician at Shalby Hospitals Ahmedabad and author of textbook of dialysis therapy. As per the guidelines of Association for Advancement of Medical Instrumentation, dialyser must be labeled properly with patient's name, registration number and other details. It must be tested after each and every use to make sure that it is working properly and it do not contain any trace of disinfectant. And patient must be monitored for any reactions for dialyser reuse are there or not. So there are some advantages and disadvantages of reuse. Advantage are cost factor, because on an average dialyser and tubing, they are going to cost between 700 to 900 rupees. So if we can do multiple use, that will decrease the cost of dialysis significantly. And this material is not biodegradable, so environmental factors remain in favor if you are going to do reuse. There are also some disadvantages of reuse. It can lead to drop in the efficiency of dialyzer that we can measure by KT by V value. Also, it can increase physical reaction. So, with hepatitis C positive patient, ideally separate reprocessing area to be there. For hepatitis B positive patient, dialysis should not be reprocessed. For HIV positive patient, reprocessing of dialyzer is safe, but still, practically, in most of the unit, single-use dialyzer are in use. The area that to be utilized for reprocessing, that should have hood and exhaust fan. The sink should have depth of at least 45 cm with drainage mesh at the depth of around 20 cm to prevent the dialyzer and tubing resting in the effluent. The performance testing that we are going to discuss later, that should be done. Visual inspection generally considered as a sole criteria in many dialysis center, but it should not be practiced. Tubing, end caps, O-ring and dialyzer header that we can use, but for that performance testing are not available. Venous and arterial transducer protector should not be reused. Ideally, protective gears to be applied by each and every operator who are involved with actual reprocessing procedure. The reason is transmission of hepatitis B is approximately 30% after mucosal exposure, around 3% for hepatitis C and 0.3% for HIV. And that is the reason that with hepatitis B, dialyzer reuse is not advisable. Now, what are the requirements for reprocessing of the dialyzer? So first is water. The water should be as per the army standards and preferably ultra pure quality. The water line pressure should be of at least 20 psi. And the washing area should have either two outlet or T connection. Why two outlets? For blood compartment and for dialysate compartment. So for blood compartment, standard tubing is adequate for connection that can be prepared by IV set. But for dialysate compartment, Hansen's connector is required. For fitting, generally 316 stainless steel material or medical graded PVC is used. Very importantly, prolonged rinse with RO water followed by reverse ultrafiltration has been shown to be an effective means of cleaning dialyzer without addition of chemical. Now the second requirement is cleaning and disinfecting agent. Ideally, it should be available online. There could be 25 to 50 liter capacity tanks that can be refilled with fresh solution every week after cleaning. And all the tanks and piping for sodium hypochlorite should be composed of medical graded PVC. And those for formaldehyde, glutaraldehyde and paracetic acid should be composed of 316 stainless steel. So now we are going to discuss about various agents. First is sodium hypochlorite. It is commercially available with strength of 10% that need to be diluted. With dilution of up to 0.6% or less, it dissolves proteinaceous deposit that may occlude the fiber. It can increase the albumin loss with reuse. That is one disadvantage with hypochlorite. Second agent is hydrogen peroxide. It is also used as a cleaning agent, generally with less than 1% concentration. It do not remove protein deposits. RO vitre is used for its dilution. It must be stored in airtight container. The reason is it's unstable. And it is to be installed in dialysate compartment, not in blood compartment. Okay. Because it can damage the blood compartment part if you are going to install it directly. Third agent that we can discuss is formaldehyde. Commercial preparations are of 40%, but we can dilute it and we can use it up to 4%. Nowadays, use of formaldehyde is comparatively significantly decreased. One side effect with formaldehyde that can be there is significant reaction. Even traces in dialyzer, so that can lead to burning sensation at start of dialysis where needle is inserted. So many of the time patients are going to complain like this at the start of dialysis, needle side, there is significant burning that can be there. One more agent, that is glutaraldehyde 2% or Cydex. It need to prepare freshly and it should be in active form. Its patency can be checked by Skip's reagent that will produce magenta color that we can see similarly with formaldehyde. It is used to preserve end caps, universal connector, O-rings and dialysis cap when it is not in use. This solution should be replaced at the interval of not less than 10 days. Peracetic acid. Generally, it is undiluted solution and so it need to be diluted with the 2% as a cleaning agent or 3.5% as a disinfectant. So to prepare 2% solution in 10 liter of water, 200 ml solution to be used, and to prepare 3.5% solution in 10 liter of water, 350 ml solution of peracetic acid to be dissolved. In many centers now, hemoclean or renalin, they are in the use. So it is a mixture of peracetic acid, hydrogen peroxide and acetic acid. It's strongly bactericidal, sporicidal, fungicidal and virucidal. Its minimum concentration to be used is 1%. This is very important. Its dwell time, minimum dwell time is 11 hours. So say for example, if the dialysis to be initiated again within 11 hours, ideally that dialyzer not to be used. It is stable for 1 week. It is to be avoided from direct sunlight exposure. Now we are going to discuss about the method of reuse. There are two methods. First is automated method and second is manual method. So for automated method, machines are available. So these machines are going to check the performance. There are three tests of performance that are estimation of total cell volume, ultrafiltration coefficient and pressure leak testing. Obviously, the machine should be capable enough to carry out disinfection cycle of its hydraulic. The chemical required for cleaning and disinfection should be connected to the machine as specified by the manufacturer. And obviously, the periodic changing of the chemicals should be carried out with check for exhaustion. So this is the machine that are in use in many dialysis center for automated reprocessing. Now, let's see what is dialyzer life cycle. This is the basic components of dialyzer life cycle, it would be same in manual as well as in automated dialyzer reprocessing. So let's discuss about manual rinse sequence. So first point is returning the blood at the end of dialysis. So it would be done by using machine's blood pump and 0.9% normal saline. See, air is very thrombogenic, so it should not be allowed to enter into the blood tubing or dialyzer. If the air is going to enter, that will lead to decrease in total cell volume and finally decrease efficiency of dialyzer. So some machine will display a message that blood is no longer detected in the extracorporeal circuit after returning the blood with normal saline. But if it is not there, generally 200 ml of saline will generally suffice to return most of the blood from the circuit. So after that, about 1000 ml of saline bottle to be further passed from the circuit after disconnecting it completely from the patient. Following this step, this is an optional step, but this will increase the efficiency of dialysis significantly. So for that, the arterial and venous tubing are to be joined with the universal connector and heparinized saline is circulated. So by this way, the residual clots that we can remove properly. Obviously, if you want to do pressure leak test, we can do here, that we are going to discuss later on. Now pre-rinsing. The dialyzer and tubing that are removed from the machine and carried to the reprocessing area in covered tray to avoid blood spills. The tubings are disconnected and the blood compartment of the dialyzer is connected to the water source. And the blood compartment is rinsed with the water till the effluent is clear. Third point is cleaning. Actually, this step is optional. Here, 1% hypochlorite can be used and it need to be instilled into the blood compartment till it is completely filled. It should not be kept for more than 2 minutes. So immediate rinse to be done and the blood compartment is the place where hypochlorite is instilled. But for hydrogen peroxide, it need to be instilled in dialysate compartment. We have already discussed for that. What is the reason? And backwashing or reverse ultrafiltration to be started after 1 to 2 minutes. Renalin that also contain hydrogen peroxide, it is again to be instilled into the dialysate compartment. So we should remember which agent to be instilled in blood compartment and which agent to be instilled in dialysate compartment. So here we are clear for that. Now visual inspection. As we discussed previously, at many centers, only visual inspection is the criteria for discarding the dialyzer. So what are the criteria that are used for visual inspection? Say for example, large number of discolored fibers, say for example more than 20%. There are large clots that we can see in header that is not dissolved, that is generalized blackening or change in the color or aesthetically unpleasant appearance. So if the clot in the header appears small and friable, the header may be removed from the dialyzer to be cleaned separately. And if the header is removed, special care to be taken to check for the O-ring. And it need to be replaced properly. If you are going to place it improperly, that will lead to blood leak. Okay. A better examination of the fiber is possible when the headers are removed. And the header and O-rings meanwhile to be kept in glutaraldehyde while the dialyzer is being reprocessed. And if the dialyzer or the header cannot be made free of the clot or too many fibers appear black, it should be discarded. Now rinsing. The cleaning agent should be rinsed out of the dialyzer with the use of water. Backwashing and reverse ultrafiltration. It is very important. Here we are supposed to understand the connections. So one end of the blood compartment is connected to the water supply, which is turned off, while the other end is left open. and one end of the dial set compartment is capped while the other end is connected to the water supply with the pressure of 1 to 1.3 bar through a Hansen's connector. The water should be entered the dial set compartment and exit through the blood compartment. Now this step is most critical and it is carried out for at least 15 minutes with the periodic 1 to 2 minute rinsing of the blood compartment, and the direction of the blood flow should be reversed at 5 minutes interval. Now finally, test of performance are there. The blood and dial set compartment are both filled with water and the both opening of the dial set compartment are kept. The dialyzer is placed over a scientific measuring cylinder and the water from the blood compartment expelled into the cylinder with the sphygmomanometer bulb or a large cylinder. This is total cell volume that we discuss in automated reprocessing or fiber well done volume. If you want to discard the dialyzer, generally the total cell volume should be less than 80% of its initial value. Now pressure leak testing. So how we can do pressure leak testing manually? So for that, the venous bubble trap is filled with saline up to 2/3 of its volume and it need to be connected to the venous pressure transducer. The venous outflow line is clamped and the blood pump runs at the speed of 100 to 150 ml per minute until the venous pressure rises to 400 mm of mercury. The blood pump is then turned off and the pressure should decrease slowly by around 1 mm per second. So if the pressure drops abruptly, there is likely to be a leak due to rupture of some of the fibers and the dialyzer should be discarded. In automated technique, it is to be measured by machine and simultaneously ultrafiltration filtration coefficient is also measured. Now filling with disinfectant. The air from the blood compartment is once again rinsed. As I said previously, it will lead to significant drop in total cell volume if the air would be inside, and that will affect the efficiency of the dialyzer. Okay, and care should be taken that both the blood and dial set compartment are completely filled with disinfectant. Okay, now labeling and storage. The patient's name, total cell volume, reuse number, the date should be marked with proper ink and it need to be fixed with the dialyzer. And it need to be sealed in polythene bag and stored in the rack with separate compartment for each dialyzer. Minimum period for storage at ambient temperature should be 24 hours for complete action of disinfectant. So if the dialyzer is stored for more than 7 days, prior to subsequent use, it should be refilled with disinfectant at this point of time. And most importantly, verification of the name on the label should be confirmed by both the dialysis person and also the patient prior to the start of subsequent dialysis to prevent errors. Now, priming and checking for residual disinfectant. Generally, 2000 ml of 0.9% normal saline is used with dialysis machine blood pump at the speed of 150 ml per minute for prime. And the dial set line should be connected and the dial set compartment filled with dial set flowing at 500 ml per minute prior to starting the priming procedure. So that will clear the dial set compartment. So if there would be a failure to dialyze the disinfectant out, then that may lead to inadequate removal and that will lead to reactions, and that can be severe many of the time. So ideally, to prevent this, we need to check for residual disinfectant. The pressure leak test may also be performed at this time. So after 2000 ml of saline priming, the effluent from the venous line should be checked for the presence of any residual disinfection. This involves using commercial test strip or Skips reagent, which gives a magenta color if the concentration of the formalin is less than 5 ppm. Similar testing with starch iodine paper may be done for parasitic acid and sodium hypochlorite, and absence of color changes with litmus or pH paper for citric acid. Prior to priming, the patient and the technician or the dialysis nurse should verify the identity of the patient and label of the dialyzer. Automated reprocessing technique usually follow the same sequence of steps but slightly modify cycle. Now, reprocessing of tubing. Actually, there is no literature available for reuse of blood tubing. However, they are reused in most units. So, the tubing R was free of blood by water and then with 1.6% solution of sodium hypochlorite. The arterial and venous bubble chambers are gently tapped to release the clots, and the side tubings are all cleaned by clamping the outlet to dislodge any adherent material. And the tubings are again rinsed with the water and then connected to the supply of 4% formaldehyde, which is allowed to completely displace water and air from the tubing. Now, taste of performance. There are no objective tests of performance are available for blood tubing. Yes, elasticity is very important. So, if it is lost, or if there are cracks are there, or there would be a slipping sound of the tubing, then these are the indicator that tubing is not in proper state to use. So, whether we are supposed to use dialyzer and tubing with the patient with acute kidney injury, ideally no. The reason is most of the time the sled or extended dialysis stations are in use and generally anticoagulants are not used. So, that will lead to significant drop in total cell volume. And again, the dialysis, they are to be done on daily basis. So, many of the time the disinfection procedure is not completed in proper way. So, now monitoring of outcome and quality control in reprocessing of the dialyzer. So, most important thing is efficiency and safety. So, efficacy is to be monitored by KT by V, and safety, that is related to physical reaction. So, maybe rigor, fever, hypotension, or if any visible change in the color of the blood in the tubing is there, dialysis to be stopped and the blood should not be returned to the patient. Sample to be collected for culture, LDH and smear examination, and the dialyzer should be rinsed with sterile normal saline and Nephron to be tested for these parameters that I mentioned. Now, there are some factors that affect the reuse of the dialyzer that are inadequate anticoagulation. So, if heparin or other anticoagulant that are not in proper quantity, that will lead to more frequent clotting. Other factors are membrane biocompatibility, inadequate priming procedure. Again, inadequate priming procedure will lead to maybe air or blood clots that will again going to affect. Obviously, low blood flow rate will lead to more blood clotting. Again, that is same with lead dialyzer. An air rinse we have already discussed. Many of the time, all the dialyzer are removed and kept in reprocessing area, and then they are reprocessed. So that delay can affect the removal of the blood clot and finally affect the efficiency of the dialyzer. And again, improper use of cleaning solution. If you are not going to maintain the cleaning solution properly, and if you are not going to check it efficiency properly, it can again affect the reuse of the dialyzer. So, to maximize the reuse, we should avoid the delay in reprocessing, achieve adequate anticoagulation, prime dialyzer properly, avoid air rinse during the termination, correct concentration of the chemical to be used as we discussed, and correct pressure during washing to be used, that again we have discussed, and we should use biocompatible dialyzer that are now in use most of the time. There are some disadvantages of opening the header during the dialyzer reprocessing. So what are the disadvantages? Not all the dialyzer, but some dialyzer, they come with openable caps. So obviously, if we are going to open it, and if many big blood clot is there, we can remove it. But if we are not going to maintain the proper procedure, that can lead to unwanted chills, rigor and fever during the treatment, and that is called header sepsis. So what is the problem? The problem is, we can see here the area of our bacteria too high, and that can lead to these reactions. So if you are going to open the cap, we need to be very conscious. So it is very important to place the header cap again in proper way. So that was all about dialysis reprocessing and reuse. So this video is to be posted on YouTube channel of Glow Media. There are cases in the form of blog that are again posted on glowmedia.com that you can go online. There are Facebook page, LinkedIn page, and if you have any query, you can mail directly. You can go on the site and you can register yourself. Thank you.